no one. If you are saved at all, some of you for the first time is going to know what it feels like to be saved, to be in church all day. I grew up and I love being in church all day. I love it. That's my Savior. That's my Lord. That's my King. That's the reason why I breathe. He does not deserve to be put on a time clock. He is the author. I don't hear nobody. And finisher. And when you get sick, you run to the rock. Y'all got to put God back where he belongs. But this is the first time in many years that I will see church all day. In many years. I don't know if I've built up my kingdom muscles for it yet. But this is like when I grew up. We are going to a guest church this afternoon. And we'll be back for our night, sir. That is, I've not seen this in years. But Shabbat, clap your hands because we're doing it on next Sunday. So they will be preaching on next Sunday. The doors of the church will open at what time? 9 a.m. Church begins at 9:30. They have their times. I want y'all up and at it so that you can get a pause between your next praise. And when we come here Sunday night, we're just going to let God have his way. And whoever's here will be here. Amen. Let's clap for next Sunday right now in Jesus' name. Our choir will be singing next Sunday night. Am I right? And we still have a guest choir coming. We have a guest choir coming doing the first part or the second part. We are singing first. Then we have a guest choir coming behind our choir on Pentecost Sunday. So we having full-blown gospel service. So let's clap and be blessed for that. Get your Bibles. Let's go to work. Can we pause and thank God for the e-church members who I know? No, clap better than that. No. I say it so often, is if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be as well off as I am. Period. The e-church looks after their pastor, and I appreciate them so very much. Amen? So let us not forget people who love us the correct way. Okay, and they're from a distance, but some of them said by the end of the year they moving here because they tired of watching. That's what they said, we tired of long distance church. So that's a lot when people can say they love your ministry so much that they will consider relocating. So let's clap for them one more time. The book of Exodus chapter 20 and then 2 Samuel chapter 21. The book of Exodus chapter 20 verse 12 and then 2 Samuel chapter 21 beginning at verse 6. Again, the book of Exodus chapter 20 verse 12 and then 2 Samuel chapter 21 verses 6 through 13. I had to find a way to keep sin in the message, but also to incorporate something about a mother. This was a difficult task today, but we're going to see what the Lord has prepared for us. Just for people who don't know where this is, I chose this scripture so that all children can get familiar with it. Exodus 20 verse 12, honor thy father, I don't hear nobody, and thy mother, that thy days be long upon the land which the Lord God has given thee, which the Lord God giveth thee. If I read it in the simple form, it would say, the more disrespect, the closer you are to dying. Every time you disrespect a parent, you lose a certain amount of days off of your life. I want to read it again because I hope they're taking it serious. This ain't just for young children, this is for grown children too. I don't care that you're grown, don't disrespect your parents. Don't tell them, stay out of my marriage. Watch your tone now, because years start peeling off. I don't care how old my children get, they're still my kids. They're grown up to society, they're still children to me. Honor thy father and thy mother, so your days may be what? Upon the land which the Lord God, thy God, giveth thee. I had to put that out there because we don't want premature funerals in our church. We want God to let you live the best life and the fullest life that you can live. Now, y'all gonna mess with me till I feel like preaching. Y'all gonna sit there as if y'all got some real reservation somewhere. Second Samuel chapter 21, verses 6 through 13. And for you that don't have mothers, stop grieving. I don't have one either. Pick another one. Find somebody. Whoever birthed you got you here. But if you want to stay here the right way, adopt a mother. Adopt a father. Stop making that the excuse for your weirdo, for you being weird. I'm like this because, no, you like this with your mother or without your mama. What you need to do is adopt a mother. We got a lot of parents going out here and adopting children. But when will children be wise enough to gaze at somebody that they respect and say, will you become my mother? No one can take the place of your mother, but you need somebody in that place. Am I right? If I think about not having a mother, I'd be depressed all weekend. Then I'll be depressed on Christmas because she was murdered on Christmas. I don't have time to go through that. I told somebody, live a life that would make her proud. Don't be a failure. I don't hear nobody. Be a success and be all that she would have been and all that you can be. Clap for that so we get rid of these excuses. 2 Samuel chapter 21. Everyone that has a baby is not a mother, but 2 Samuel. There's a difference in a mother and a mommy, a father and a daddy. There is a huge difference. Your father, who has not been there, beat you and go off. You want to fight him back and go off and leave and never talk to him. Your daddy beat you, you're going to say, I love you by that night. Because real parents will beat you, make you wash your face, come to the table, y'all don't know what I'm talking about, and eat. And you be like, I ain't hungry. They be like, I made your favorite chicken. And by the end of the night, y'all out bowling, watching TV, because that's your mommy. That's your daddy. And let me say one more thing, being that y'all sitting there like I'm not preaching. Some of you parents, stop being your children friends. That's going to raise a retarded generation. I'm your mother, I am your father, I'm not your buddy. Again, you read Exodus 20 and 12, but I want to say it again. Honor thy father and thy mother, so that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. 2 Samuel chapter 21, beginning at verse 6, concluding the reading at verse 14. Now, we don't want to dwell on the historical content of this. We want to dwell on the intent of why I'm bringing this scripture into focus. Let seven men of his sons be delivered to us, and we will hang these seven men up unto the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, whom the Lord did choose. And the king said, I know you're not familiar with the story, but at least read it. The king said, I will give them. But the king spared Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, because the Lord's oath that was between them, between David and Jonathan, the son of Saul. But the king took the two sons of Rizpah, the daughters of Aiah, whom she bare unto Saul, Armoni and Mephibosheth, and the five sons of Michal, the daughter of Saul, whom brought up for Adriel, the son of Barzillai, the Meholathite. And he delivered them into the hands of the Gibeonites, and they hanged them in the hill before the Lord, and they fell all seven together, and were put to death in the days of harvest, in the first days, in the beginning of the barley harvest. Now, don't y'all worry about it, because I know you don't know nothing that I'm reading, most of you. It was hard enough that we got to pronounce the names. I should have said, read. Rizpah, the daughter of Aiah, took sackcloth and spread it for her upon the rock from the beginning of the harvest until the water dropped upon them out of heaven, and suffered neither the birds of the air to rest on them by day, nor the beasts of the field by night. And it was told David what Rizpah, the daughter of Aiah, who was a concubine, there go another one, of Saul, had done. David went and took the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan his son from the men of Jabesh Gilead, which had stolen them from the street of Bethshan, where the Philistines had hanged them when the Philistines had slain Saul in Gibeah. And he brought up from thence the bones of Saul, the bones of Jonathan his son, and they gathered the bones of them that were hanged. He brought them up from thence, the bones of Saul, the bones of Jonathan his sons, and gathered the bones of them that were hanged. And verse 14 said, and the bones of Saul and Jonathan, his son, are buried in the country of Benjamin in Zillah, in the sepulchre of Kish, his father. And they performed all that the king commanded. And after that, God entreated for the land, which means the famine ended. I want you to look at verse 9 and 10 again. I'm sorry that I'm boring you with an unfamiliar passage. And he delivered them into the hands of the Gibeonites, and they hanged them, these boys, on the hill before the Lord, and there fell seven together, and put them to death in the days of harvest, in the first days, the beginning of the barley harvest. Verse 10, Rizpah, the daughter of Aiah, took sackcloth, spread it for her upon the rock, from the beginning of harvest until the water dropped upon them out of heaven, and suffered, underscore, neither the birds of the air to rest on them by day, nor the beasts of the field by night. You can let out guessing. Somebody shout amen. Amen. I have a topic, but I think it's because of your silence that I'm going to... No. I think I'm gonna simplify this quick. I was gonna take you down the journey, but you don't seem like you're ready for the trip. Most people who can preach only preach what they're familiar with. Most folk who are preachers go on research. They want to say something no one else has said. All I'll say about verse 9 and 10, just to give you a heads up, is a woman's sons have been hanged. Let me make it personal. A mother's five boys have been given up and hanged. And even though they died, this mother's responsibility to her sons was she took soft cloths, put them in a hard spot. Y'all quiet. To keep the vultures off her children. She took soft cloths, put them in a hard place. I want to preach. And did a mother's responsibility, which was to keep the devourers, the vultures, off her children. My topic for this morning, well, afternoon now, for 10 folk who were screaming, I'll go on, is get it off me. Look at somebody and tell them, get it off me. Just get it off me. I might as well extend it. Get it off me and then keep it off me. If somebody truly loves you, they won't let the worst thing have you. They will posture themselves in a hard place. Oh, y'all don't hear me. And do what they are chosen to do. If you're a mother, you have a job, a real obligation. And that is not trying to find a daddy for your children. That's learning how to fight for your kids if you got to do it all. I don't think, and I'm going to preach to everybody, but I don't think you women know how powerful you really are. You allow your pitiful to outshine your powerful. I would that every home had both parents, but it's just not reality. Give me some grown-ups that'll talk to me. But I definitely want to give high kudos to women who did everything you could on your own to help us become who we are. Kudos to all of you. Now, this is a different type of Mother's Day sermon. Because I want to show the side of motherhood that most people never get to see. And that is, most mothers, or even potential mothers, any woman, young lady in here with a womb, you have the power to become a potential mother. So you need to know what your responsibility is before you get pregnant. All right, no claps on the mother section. And that it is not your parents' job to raise your children. You're not going to have the fun and give me the responsibility. You're going to take care of that child. You can drop them by my house for like 2 days. That's the longest. Then they going back to the folk that had the fun. Different type of Mother's Day sermon. A true mother's job, which is never seen, and I want to preach it, is to protect the family. You don't have to clap, I'm going to preach. We often say men are the protectors, but I differ with that. We are providers. Well, men are protectors too. I protect my family. Not if you cheat on her, lie to her. Protectors don't cheat. Now you can shake your head around or look around this way. Protectors don't cheat. Or you would protect her heart, her mind, her emotions. Men are providers. That's why we're always throwing your face. I got the lights on. Food in the fridge. We brag about our provision. What bothers me, this ain't Father's Day. Don't y'all be acting like y'all want some good to be said about y'all. But what bothers me is, how can we throw in your face what God gave us to do for you? God gave Adam the garden, then gave him someone to share it with. It was never really yours. It was given to you, and you got to give it to somebody else. Men are providers. That's why a man that does not take care of his house is worse than an infidel. That's the scripture. And some of you got pregnant by infidels. That's why there's a child support system in place. If you have the fun, bring the funds. See, the word fun, you add another D to it, that's what it's going to cost you, some funds. My stance is very biblical, not personal. That I would say that real women that are mothers and etc., and those who have wombs, that you are the protector of the family. Men are the providers. Why do you say, Pastor, that we are the protectors? Because I've never heard it like that. Because my mother said, find a man who will protect and provide. Let me tell you why, for three women who will stand, because you're gracious and you understand your role. You are what you are made from. You women, when you study the genesis of your creation, you are made from the structure of the rib. Ribs are there to protect the vital organs of the body. So when a woman goes off on her man saying, watch her, even though he be like, I don't like her, I don't care if she like me, it's because she's functioning in her creation. And that is, I see it way before you do. That's why she has what's called intuition. And if you don't let her see in, you'll be paying tuition. Now be seated. It's bad to have a woman who's a prophet and has intuition. Boy, she got eight set of eyes. She busted you in her dream. I had a dream. Her name is Allen. It's crazy. I saw a girl with blonde hair, huh? Real mothers know how to stop you before you start. She's made from the rib, and that particular bone structure protects what's behind it. Kidneys, livers. Sometimes you will hear this, and I need talkers because I want to preach. I don't think talking will mess up your clothes, all right? But I have heard many doctors say that the bullet ricocheted off the rib. That if you didn't have a strong rib cage, the bullet would have punctured your organ, but because of the fourth rib in this section. So Satan knows, if I want to kill a man, I got to break a woman, right? And every time there's a broken woman, there's access to a man. Man, my wife's strong. She's not just strong for her. She might be too strong for you, but she's equipped to block what's coming. All right, I thought I was gonna be able to teach it. I should have took the quick route like I promised. I wouldn't be offended right now. Do you know how many demons would have had some of us men if she'd have just sided with the devil's assignment? Hell has no fury like a woman scorned. Men can't even take women down because there's always another woman there to bring her back up. But when men go down, ain't no man there. They just be like, man, I'm praying for you. I got to go grocery shopping if you'd have called me. Men, get out of here. I ain't gonna even bother y'all because y'all just... They protect the vital organs of the body. So being that you know that, I want you to look at your neighbor and say, do what you were created to do. No, look at them until they understand that you're demanding a responsibility out of that. And to do what you were created to do. Being that you didn't like that, I might as well talk a little bit more about the rib. The rib, Howie, is one of the only bones in the physical anatomy that if it breaks, there's no surgery. It's self-mending. If a man get broken, he needs his aunt, his grandmama, his mother, his girlfriend. But when a woman's broke, she normally goes off into seclusion. Oh yeah, and she goes into what's called self-mending. But now that bone also has a memory. Other parts of the body don't. But that rib has a memory. Women forgive, but they don't forget. Because of what you're made out of. Ribs have a memory. So when that bone, I wish I was talking about, gets cracked, you're in pain. You can barely breathe. Because of the rib cage. When the rib cage is not functioning, it's hard. You take small breaths because your whole cavity hurts. Y'all standing or y'all talking? And you take them from the outside. You got to take the ribs around your body. Nothing can be done internally. The rib starts talking to itself. It records how hard the blow was. When it mends back strong enough that if it gets that blow again, it won't break. Y'all ain't sure. Women are not strengthened through prayer. You're strengthened through brokenness. Now let me get out of here. Every time someone breaks you, that is God summoning you to be stronger for what's coming down the road. Now, some of you mothers, this is a great sermon for y'all, and y'all ain't talking because you just figuring out that, listen, I'd have been broke at least 20 times, so you ought to be 20 times stronger. And the reason why the first three men hurt you is you weren't ready for them. You were getting strong for who was coming. See, you let brokenness tell you where you are is not where you belong. Now, if I was men, I'd be saying amen through the whole sermon, right? Because if you keep hurting with who you're with, you are equipping her for where she's going. When that rib heals, Bishop, it heals strong enough that the only way it's going to get cracked again is the next blow must be harder. Now, if a woman or mother has ever said anything close to this and you don't get up and scream, then I know you ain't serious. Have you ever said, ain't nothing else you can do to me? You done did it all and I'm still here. If you say any statement like that, you are letting the situation know I'm 10 times stronger than I was when we first met. Ain't nothing else you can do to me except kill me. And a ghetto mother be like, and before you think about that, see, you men gotta go to sleep. Y'all act deep all you want to. You gotta go to sleep. She gotta cook your food. Women have too many roads to get us. I see a visitor ain't stood one time. He looked nervous. But it's okay. Man, men, the male species, we are made from dirt. Every real man has a little dirt with him. I said last morning. And if a man that's full of dirt gets the right woman with seed, and she knows how to water that seed that's in her pile of dirt, then she has something to protect. I'm not gonna protect mud. Mud is dirt and water with no seed. Some of y'all crying over mud. God made the dirt, God also made the rain, but he gave you the seed. Some of y'all wasted time with some of us because you kept playing with something you can't get out of you because it's mud. Mud is hard to get out of you. Hard to get off your shoes, hard to get out your dress. Now, if y'all are near other women that are mothers and they ain't saying amen, you need to know that that's just a baby's mama. Because if they're serious about being what they were created to be, they'd be sitting up straight and say, girl, did you hear that? Joe did. They're not doing theirs happen by happenstance. Even Jesus, who is the seed of David, went to a woman and asked, can I borrow your womb? And he got in a woman who was not presently married. He allowed himself to be born the hood way, where they said, could anything good come out of Nazareth? Even Jesus' mama, God had to tell his stepdaddy, Joseph, get them out of here because their life is being threatened. So that's where men think they were the protector. No, they obeyed an order that was given by God. The man took her away, but he didn't even know when to bring her back. God had to send another message 2 years later and say, them that seek his life are dead. Yelling, the devil's not after you, he's after what you're carrying. Now, that's why your real ministry is to protect the seed. If a son has a mother and a father and he was raised right and he becomes disobedient and very rebellious, most of the time, at least within the black African American diaspora, we hear something like this. He in jail, the father said, the Negro belong in there. I taught him better. The mother said, that's my son. He was a son when he wasn't a criminal and he's still a son. Now that he a criminal, father be like, that's your boy. That ain't who I raised. Fathers don't stay. He's only ours when he gets a scholarship and makes $10 million. Now he look like his daddy. But when he's doing mess, go to your mama. Y'all see, y'all don't believe that, right? He's ours when he's dressed well and people say, that's such a pretty baby. He's hers when he starts smelling and got a mess. Be like, take him to his mama. So he's the mother's when he needs to be changed. I think I just lost everybody. But then when is he the father's? Like, for real. Look somebody and tell them, do your job. Do what you were created to do. One person's disobedience can cause havoc in the whole community. This is commentary research. The law says, do not drink and drive. So one drunken driver can cause tremendous headache on many people. The other three in the car were not drunk, but they also were not driving, but they're paying a penalty for letting a drunk drive. All right, y'all are quiet now. And a real mother, when she protects the family, she holds to her law. You will not drink in this house. You will not bring another boy in your bedroom. You've got to become a police officer. Oh, y'all quiet. And you gotta have them rules. If I dare find out, they don't like me today right now. Y'all need to be glad I ain't your daddy, because I kill you. See, mothers know how to nurture, fathers know how to murder. See, it's two different places. Your mama tell you, get out, and a week or 2 days later, come home and let's talk. Father say, get out, you come visit, who you here for? You don't live here. Matter of fact, call first. One drunken driver has the lives of everyone in the car in their hands. Similarly, one immoral sex act can bring devastation to an entire family. Y'all are quiet. Y'all are not where I'm going. This incident in the book of 2 Samuel concerning David and these deaths, it occurs because God made a covenant through Joshua with the people, y'all don't hear me, that you can never ever betray this tribe because you let them fool you into getting in. Nobody, I told you they didn't know the text, and my leaders ain't talking to me because they didn't know the text. Gibeon lied years ago and said, we are not from Philistines. And Joshua believed him because they came with wine and clothes and mold. And he said, we shall forever have covenant with you. And once they cut covenant, they pulled off their disguise. And God says, the oath is the oath. See, some of you are putting up with mess because you let the disguise fool you. And now all of a sudden, you want to start over. There is no start over. He treated me so nice, so I thought he loved me. That's how people do. They got to gain your trust. They're not treating you nice. Real men don't start off treating folk nice.
for fun. They treat you nice because we have a mission. He opens all my car doors, pulls out all my chairs. Real men don't do that all the time. He take me to the hair salon and wait on me. Ain't no real man doing that all the time. He like walking through the mall. He like what I like. Ain't no real man. We are opposites. It takes a real woman an hour or more just to get herself together in the bathroom. It take men 20 minutes. You be like, you ready to go? Jesus Christ, how you... And the woman say, why are you rushing me? Did you wash all your body parts? How you do this? And men be like, we gotta go. I'm ready. I told you 20 minutes. Be careful making a covenant with a disguiser. Will you tell your neighbor what I just said? Be careful. That was in Joshua chapter 9, verses 3 through 27, when all of this occurred. So now the problem is, years later, there's a group of people that attacked the Gibeonites. And God said, I told your fathers that they could never touch them. So now the sins of the fathers, y'all, has caught up with their children. Y'all missed that too. The sins of the father. I want to say this to the children, and I'm hoping three folk catch it. Some of you are paying for what we did. And what we're doing is trying to beat us out of you. Oh, y'all didn't catch that. I don't do it, you ain't gonna do it. But tell them how long you used to do it before you say you don't do it. They really hate that a part of them is showing up in you. You too fast, cause you were Speedy McGreedy too. You having a child at 18, finished college. You had yours at 15, be fair. See how the mother stopped laughing? Now they're like. We can add up your age minus the age of your child and come up. It's not hard anymore. We can add up your anniversary and your oldest child and know that you got married after. All we have to do is do the math. And it's funny that when you did it, it wasn't nothing, but when they do it, it's demons. Because you're trying to beat yourself out of your children. And the only reason why you're doing that is you were not created a protector. So now God has to penalize his people for breaking covenant with the Gibeonites, and the penalty was, give us five of your sons, let us hang them. And then God tells David and them, give them the children. I'm gonna make a statement. It's profound, but some of you don't think it is because you'd rather have prophecy right now. But let me say this to five people who will jump. Sometimes you got to kill a few things for one thing to live. Now I want to talk about that. Some of you have not begun to live until you kill what needs to die. But some of you are trying to keep your hands in both pots. Now Tawana's pushing me today, but the rest of you are not. And we'll find out why in a minute. The Lord promised them it's going to be a famine until you make recompense. The recompense is whatever they ask for. they asked for five lives. Sometime for you to get back in your harvest, you've got to kill a few relationships. Now, some of you ain't gonna clap because you're keeping one on life support in case it really changed. A single violation of the Lord will cause misery, not just for you, but for your family. Saul was already dead. But yet the covenant he made has now gone over into Jonathan and David's camp. If sin can't get the first generation, it'll go for the next. All right. And if the first generation does not protect the next generation, it will go to the next. Somebody has to be strong enough to say the buck stops here. If I got three people serious about living, just shout the buck stops here. The Gibeonites did not ask for those five lives for revenge. They had no malice. The Gibeonites said, this is what it's going to take for it to rain. God said, I'm not going to keep giving you money to fund your fetishes. I'm tired of your children calling your lover uncle. Y'all ain't talking to me. I'm tired of all of this. He's our cousin. Who is it? How you wind up marrying your God brother? How y'all do this? Yep, that's why all the women got Morse code now. They like... I thought you said, what's your cousin? He my play cousin. Oh, because now y'all involved. He the play. He my brother, but not blood. You know why some of you laughing? It's hard to explain something that you made rules for. Single violation. We live in a community where our lives can affect one another. Our lives, what you do, Frank, could affect me. What I do could affect Maze. What Maze does could affect Hope. What Hope does could affect Joe. What Joe does can affect Dr. Mixon. What all of you leaders do affect the name of the church. What the church does gets an infection to the community. Everything you do, you've got to do it with someone else in mind. When you think about other people, you may not do what you plan on doing because the after effect, I don't hear nobody, is critically dangerous. Am I boring y'all in the middle today? I think I'm boring people in the middle today. I'm almost there. I'm about to go to work. They take the kids. They hang them. What hanging does is it exposes you to slow death. Hanging is not instantaneous. It's to embarrass you. Oh, yeah. So when folk hang you, you're still living. And it shows them you jerking and body gyrating and feces coming out. Y'all ain't talking to me and it's not coming, eyes rolling back. It's meant to embarrass. Now, if I say this and some men don't jump women on the screen because it's your day, I will be offended. But sin is to make us look embarrassed. The wages of sin, y'all don't like it, is death. The type of death is hanging. Sin wants to choke us out. Y'all ain't. Now, what I like about this story is all five sons are slowly dying. And a real mother has to watch. She cannot stop them from killing the sons. Y'all ain't gonna scream, because the sons have been released by God. Sometimes for mothers to be effective, you got to give these kids over to God. Y'all quiet. And you get out of the picture. Let God strangle that disobedience out of them. See, quiet in the back. They're watching them run. When you say, listen, ain't nothing harder than a woman or a mother giving up on her children. When a real mother gives up on that child has real problems. Like critical, something wrong with y'all. Let me talk to the children. If your mama don't like you, something wrong with you. I just watched Karamo in the place of Mari Povich, and he had a young girl who was 14 disrespecting her mother who was in a wheelchair, and her mother was forceful and could tame her, but the daughter knows that the mother is restricted. So she was going off. I said, if that girl was living in the right neighborhood, three other mothers would have came outside. See, I don't get why y'all don't want me to preach this. You mothers gotta stop agreeing with the children. And do what we used to do. Take the child to the mama and be like, now tell her what you told me. See, I don't need to preach. And if I find out you're lying, I'm gonna tear you up right here in front of her. Tell her, y'all don't go fight no teacher. You bring the child to the teacher and tell the child, tell me. That's why I couldn't be a teacher. You come to me fussing at me about your children, I'm gonna beat up you and your child. You're not gonna yell at me in my classroom putting up with your hard-headed, disobedient, uncontrollable child. And I'm getting paid the lowest salary in the world to put up with your, no way, you're not doing that. I quit, meet me outside. My last lesson I'm gonna teach is you. Could it not be, Dr. Mixon and all of you, in about 10 minutes I'm gonna go to my preaching level, but let me say this for three folk who are learning. Could it not be that these children have died because of dishonor? Because if God told Joshua never touch the Gibeonites, when did that rule change? Somebody probably told the children we cannot mess with them, and these children decided we don't care no more. That was years ago. That's how children make mistakes. They say we old. And how we used to do it. Y'all know that ain't the way it's done anymore. These kids come in and nuke all the food and claim they cooked food for their boyfriend in the microwave. What? Come to my house to eat. Food's almost ready. If I see it's in the microwave, I'm like, I'm out, because we've been taught that when you love a person, love is in the preparation of the meal. See, some of you ain't clapping because you done lost it too. You ain't got no man because you ain't got no recipe. See, some of you, I'm still here to tell you the way to a real man's heart is not through a restaurant. That's why the woman you call ugly took him from you, because she could cook. Now, all you young women that can't cook, don't get offended. This is a Mother's Day sermon. This mother. And then I see a lot of women in here looking at me who are mothers, but I've actually never seen you in here with your children. I've never seen you in here with your man. You be up in here jumping, shouting, speaking in tongues, and where are they? Then we find out some of you holiest women are married to men that don't even believe in God, don't believe in church, don't. But he a good man. I ain't asking if he good. He going to hell good. I ain't asking if he good. Y'all look at me funny. If your husband ain't saved, he going to hell. I'm just telling you. But we can't find one in the church. That's one excuse. How about you can't get him to come to church? That's another one. So he's good enough for you and him to touch and make babies, but not good enough to bring him to God. This is weird. He don't believe in tongue speaking. Then he don't believe in you because you speak in tongue. I need to understand this. Now, I got three or four angry. I feel you. Don't text me because you might get your feelings critically hurt. Because I've been concerned about this since I've seen you. And I need to know how you this spiritual and your house ain't here with you. And you worried about other people's homes when your home ain't here either. It's quiet. But the Gibeonites did not require these deaths because they wanted revenge. They needed it because they knew to get God back in a place of grace, you gotta pay. Sin wants a life. In vain, listen, do we expect mercy from God? We don't get mercy until we make up for the injustice. All right, I don't hear educated. Executions must not be thought in this case to be cruel. They are preparing a beach. Sometimes the people that hurt you actually helped you. Because you would have never gone to the next level if you were comfortable in the level that you were in. Y'all are real quiet this afternoon. The person you used to cry over, you now laugh at. What used to be your throat is now your joke. Y'all ain't talking. I can't believe I cried over him. Then when you see who he is a few years later and who he's with and how he's looking, you be like, Lord, I want to thank you. Lord, I thank you so much. I wish it was Men's Day because I'd have said that about us men. Because I used to love a girl in high school. I ain't going to say her name. But I saw her a couple years ago. She had 8 kids and she was not like she was in high school. And I was at the gas pump. And I said, Father, I want to thank you for your goodness and your mercy. And she said, we need to go talk about the past. I said, that's the only thing we can talk about. We sure can't talk about a future. There are some people you need to avoid because they're not in your future. Not in the relationship of sex or marriage at all. They have nothing to offer. And when people have nothing to offer, all they do is offend. Everything's a question. So I heard. What you doing? Everything is looking for something to talk about. I think I done lost half the church again. I haven't seen you in church in 2 weeks. Now, is this out of concern or out of being nosy? Have you joined another church yet? What's going on with you? I'm praying for you. Do you need to know all of this? Because if God is using you, then you should be able to get to a point. All right, I'm going to leave that alone because this side ain't talking. I noticed you wore the same shoes for 3 weeks. Now, are you being nosy or insulting? Or are you going to take me out to buy me a pair of shoes? I noticed you've been catching an Uber, and I know you had a car. What's wrong with your car? Where did it go? Now, after I tell you, are you going to help me resolve my transportation issue? I need to know why you are asking me. Is that your car too? That sounds like jealousy. Next few months you'll be like, is that your car three? Y'all ain't talking to me. Then later on you really want to ask me, can you use my second car? But you got to disguise yourself like you're my friend. See, y'all just missed it. I went back to the disguise. You cannot assign yourself to me playing a role that's not you. I respect you, but ain't no but after respect. That means you don't respect at all. I respect you, but. When a person say you are pretty, but they're saying you're not really pretty. I see some men who've not smiled yet because they only came to church with their baby mama, so they really not present, they just here. They're about to go drink on Mother's Day. They're about to kick it soon as this is over. But you the protector. Executions must not be thought of as cruel. Last thing I want to say here, then we'll go to the last layer of this text, because some of you didn't like it. But 10 of you that will catch this will scream glory after you catch it. And that is this, and I want to say this as nicely as I can. Because I'm no longer treating you the same don't mean I'm cruel. Well, things went different when you started treating me different, because I'm not the same as I was. And if you still want me, you keep changing while I'm changing, because I'm trying to be somebody while you trying to be the same. It's not cruelty. If you keep changing for the other person who don't want to change, you're being cruel to yourself. That's why I said Mahashiyanda, I'm sorry. That's why I said, I feel the Holy Ghost now, that we cannot see this action of execution as cruel punishment. This contract was written years before now. Somebody forgot the contract. And on this, if mothers don't jump on this, well, you probably got on your nice clothes. But if you don't respond on this, then I can't help you. Children do get grown. Children change. Children fly off at the mouth. But you've got to always tell them, don't forget who I am. See, a child breaks the contract when you start acting like you grown. You follow that? At that time, I got to handle you like you grown. I got to hang you. I gotta lift you up off your feet. I can't believe you put your hands on me. I'm your mother. And I brought you in this world. See, y'all don't even have this rule anymore. I don't believe in hitting children. Just put them in time out. Yeah. Time out is getting that child ready for time served. They going to jail. That's why scripture says, spare the rod, you spoil the child. That means you make your child no good for society. Some of you are good for work, just not good for social living. That's why you got a good job in bad company. You're not created for society. Before I go to my last level, and I'm going to be in a B, let me go way back to the book of Genesis and tell you this for three people. Eve is made out of a what? So how in the world was the serpent able to get to Adam unless Eve was not doing her job? See, it got quiet. Women's problem is not cheating with men, it's telling your business to other women. When women don't get enough attention, they just start talking. And they really talk to the disguised woman who acts like she's her friend. And then that woman starts talking to everybody in your circle. And then when folk treat you cruel, you think something of them? You should never talk to a stranger about a friend. Never. Why? I want to preach. Why would Eve be talking to a serpent? They have nothing in common. They can't kiss each other. They can't sleep together. They can't procreate together. Why is this woman hanging around with a serpent? And why, I can't get help, has she never rebuked the serpent who's trying to change the rules that God gave to her and her man? She should have said, Negro, talk to my man. Because I wasn't created when God spoke to him, but he told me what God said. I said Negro, that's not a bad word. I said Negro. I have no nice word for a serpent. Some of y'all so saved, you nice to the wrong people. I have nothing nice to say about a rapist, about a liar, about a... I have no nice words for that. He's a kind liar. I never heard of a kind liar. Kindness is his disguise. Liar is who he is. Now let me get out of here. I say this so often, women don't leave men for cheating, they leave them for lying. And in this day and time, women cheat more than men. Look up the statistics. Look at, oh no, don't shrug, look at the statistics. Oprah said it, so I know you believe it. Oprah ain't never said that. Yes, she did. I ain't never sat with so many women who don't mind cheating until this century. Not ever. I used to hear women defending who they are. I'm the one, and if not, and my mama raised me right. Now the women be like, hey, if you do it, I can do it. Y'all different now. I wish there was a scripture for legally marrying you because we be friends. Just ain't no scripture for marrying somebody who let you have somebody else. Oh boy, they wanted me to be nice to a sin? I just admitted, and y'all left me out there, that I wish there was a scripture for you. We would have a peaceful marriage. I'm going out with my boyfriend. Tell him I said hello. I would not miss you even after you came back. I'd just be happy that the dynamics of cheating is gone. These new mothers, they're a little different. Scary. Because the way you're living, how can you protect me? You're too busy to protect. You're too preoccupied to protect. I got to get out of here because I done made some enemies. Help me preach. Eve, you did not, I know you're in heaven now, you did not do your job as the mother of the world. You should have took your high heel shoe and beat that serpent right in his head. Then I'm going to get real women to talk. You should have went to your man and be like, you need to talk to that serpent because he tries to talk to me every day. You should have made Adam grab that serpent by the neck and tell KC, King Cobra. He should have. The serpent could talk better than Adam because he was more subtle than any beast in the garden. That word subtle in the New Jack definition, for those who would scream, full of swag. Psst. Tongue always flicking. Psst. If I was human, what would you do? Let me tell you. And tomorrow, meet me out here again. Men cheat in bed, women cheat in head, but let's move on and I'll talk to y'all later. Women are cheating when they're having conversation. Men are cheating and don't want to talk. Can't we talk after? Let's talk on Monday. See, real women should have said amen, but you super holy women that act like this ain't going on in your family. May not be going on in your relationship, but I bet it's going on in your family. And you don't even know how to address it. I just pray. Eve didn't do a job. I'm about to transition. And the Bible says, Dr. Sharon, that she was fooled. She was beguiled. Adam, let me talk to men who ain't upset on Mother's Day. He was not fooled at all. He needed someone to blame, which meant he always wanted to eat. Y'all ain't tell, he always, but he needed someone to feed it to him. Oh yeah. So he could tell God, it's the woman. Oh, y'all don't want me to preach. I'm about to. That you gave me. So he, in all actuality, is not blaming Eve. He's blaming God. If God didn't want me to do it, he should have stopped me. No, no. You got to love him enough not to do it. God ain't stopping none of us. I wish I had some hand claps there, maybe online. God loves you enough to let you make your decisions and to live with the decisions that you make. Last time, because I'm being redundant now. Eve did not do her job. But I might as well throw this out there for three women who will jump on one man. But Jezebel did. The one y'all call a hoe, a harlot, no good makeup. She had one husband, made sure nobody took what was his. She protected. And I wrote a note and y'all ain't screaming. You can learn sometimes more from who ain't saved than you can from them that are saved. Saved people are disguisers. Y'all don't want me to preach this. They're one way this week, this way the next week. But a sinner, even though they're not a bad person, they're just not saved. Y'all got the word sin and bad mixed up. Some of you are saved and bad. People can't stand being around you because they're afraid of my anointing. Anybody afraid of your anointing? With your broke self. Ain't nobody afraid of your anointing with your lonely self. Ain't nobody afraid of no anointing. Satan was anointed. Did you read that? Satan, the anointed cherub. Satan. The anointing is not the same as being filled with the Holy Ghost. We got a lot of anointed folk going to hell. Just no one with the Holy Ghost. Look how quiet it got now. What? I like Jezebel. I just wish she was saved. Jezebel ain't no harlot. She ain't sleeping around with nobody. She waiting on her husband. A lot of things y'all can learn for Jezebel. She only put on makeup, Estee Lauder, Mary Kay, Lancome, whatever African products y'all use that you call natural. She only put that on when she was going to kill somebody. So when they knew she was upset, she would disguise herself. Yeah. Like when y'all put on these holy clothes this morning. That one, you, that. You want to know how a person really dressed? Go see their closet. Go look at the closet. Look in the underwear drawer. You see? You be like, this a harlot. She only got two hangers of white clothes. Y'all didn't hear wrong about Jezebel? Only problem God had with Jezebel is she kept on serving the wrong God. Jezebel is so on point for a woman who would jump, who's learning, that she married one of God's men. Ahab saved. But Jezebel too strong for him because he started serving her God. Yelling. See, you can't get in a relationship that pulls you away from how you were raised right because the other person has everything that makes you feel good. She married a man of God. She married God's servant, but God's servant was not focused enough. And she became his protector. If Jezebel was in the garden with Adam, that serpent would have been dead. The only way to kill a snake is to cut off the head. Now that's why Jezebel cuts off heads. You want to kill a serpent? Yeah. When you're in my office getting rebuked, I don't let you leave with a scar. You leave looking for your neck. I'm not a woman. Ain't no scratching. You leave with two feelings. Either I'm going to stay or I ain't never coming back. And I leave with one feeling. I do not care. Y'all heard me? Because we're not raising a church full of serpents, disguisers, betrayers. Here's how I close. What is about to fly my kite, Howie, but what is the posture of this woman? She says, I'm going to let them hang my sons, but I'm not going to let people pick on them. They're going to die looking like they should. And she takes some soft covers and puts them in a hard place. Y'all quiet in the front. And there she has two jobs. By night, she has to keep foxes and beasts and lions, things that should scare her. She now has a reason to face her fears, because this is my family. And even though they're dead, they'll be buried decent.
Oh yeah.
You will not take a leg or a limb. She fights off lions, tigers, and bears. Then here comes vultures and everything. She fights from above and beneath. She is fighting all my life. I feel like preaching now. She has to quit her job. Take a leave of absence. See, y'all don't feel your mother's pain, do you? You don't know what mothers really sacrifice for kids. They could have been much further enjoying themselves, but they had children. Y'all ain't talking. And then children want more than they deserve while you're not even doing what your mother asked you to do. She has to stop working. She puts in the letter. I need time off. Her supervisor says, what are you going to do? She says, I'll be working day and night. Got me working, working. You got me working. Real children will be a job. Raising kids is a job all by itself. See, you parents should be talking now, because it'll help your children understand. It gets so serious you can't even romance or have a date if the kid's home. You gotta be quiet in your own house. Come over, but please be quiet, because my daughter is in the left. It's crazy. Then them nosy kids get up. You know, I heard somebody over here last night. See, y'all don't want to preach to me. I used to be one of them kids. What's your new job? I'm fighting away everything that's trying to devour my family. Nobody's out there helping you? No. You need any help? No. How long you gotta do it until the rain comes? Oh, y'all don't hear me now. And I want to say this quick so I can get happy. All of you that have fought for your family, it's about to rain. And I'm going to tell you about it. All of the stuff you thought that you didn't have time to get, it's about to come back around. That's because all day and all night, fighting. Fighting. I know the devil's made some of us want to give up on our kid because our kid is so rude. But something deep down that's embedded in real mothers, they never give up. Even when y'all say it, you mean it and can't do it. Way down in there. I'm about to preach. And you children, y'all have been disrespectful today, not applauding your parents, standing on certain statements. Your day's short. Your marriage going in as quick as you got married? Your day is short. Your children going to be demon possessed right away. This was the day when children should have applauded everything. But these old ungrateful, uncircumcised Gibeonites. They rather go out with their boyfriend to eat today versus their parent. You know that? That's just these uncircumcised Gibeonites. If they had a real boyfriend, they'd have told their boyfriend, "You taking me and my mama out to dinner." If you don't know how to treat my mama, see, I want to preach, then you ain't got nothing to say to me. Uncircumcised Philistine. Sinful enough to have sex with you, broke enough not to take care of you. You lost your virginity and your job. Oh, I'm sorry, I lost it. The parent in me came out. That's the parent in me. No, that wasn't pastor right there. That was a parent. What happened, Howie? That every day this woman is being caught fighting her fears. She's letting all of the principalities of the world know, you will not get my children. Uh-oh, it's quiet. She's letting everything around her know to get to them. Oh, I would. You got to come through me. She's a Cat Williams. This one right here. Oh, yeah. This one right here. Point at somebody and tell them, "I got to get him off you. I can't let him have you." Tell them, "I don't know your business, but I know that if you're anointed, the devil's after you. And I'm sitting next to you in a hard place to let you know that if he did it for anybody else in the Bible." There are things, let's go home, flying over some of your heads that you cannot fight because you're hanging right now. That God has put a love in someone to set up shop in your hard place. Their job is to get you from between the rock and the hard place. The person sitting next to you right now don't know that they were chosen by God to sit that close to you, to let the principalities of hell know you cannot have them. We are not selfish. We are concerned about each other. I'm not gonna let you drive drunk. See, there's some things when people are concerned about you, they cannot let you do. I can't let you sit near me and still be dreary and still be sad and you ain't moved off service. What got you so weighted down? Whatever it is, it's got to go. Tell two or three people and mean it when you tell them it's got to get up off you. Tell them if you let it go, I'll keep it off you. Tell them I came with some soft covers so I can sit in a hard place. I know it's hard for you to trust me because you've been hurt by everybody else. I knew it wouldn't be easy to get close to you, but I refuse to give up on you because something in you says you are a chosen child of God. Look at somebody, get them off you, and tell them you've got too much in you for me to let the devil have you. Tell them I ain't got to be your mother. I don't have to be your father. I don't have to be your sister. I don't have to be your brother. But on this Mother's Day, I'd be a mother if I let the devil have you today. Oh, y'all didn't like that either. Every spirit in hell is looking at some of you like, you ain't their mother, you ain't their father, but I am my brother's keeper. And I want everybody in this house to remember, it was on Mother's Day that God gave birth to the new you. Oh, good God, right now. Old things are passed away. I'll watch it how, and behold, all things are become new. Look at somebody, act like you're celebrating, and tell them, let me just get this off me. Tell them, I made some bad decisions. I've done some terrible things. But in my heart, I'm a loving person. But I'm so glad today that God was honest enough to look me in my face and tell me, you messed up, but I'm about to get you back where you belong. And I'm telling God, if you just give me one more chance. Oh, y'all know here. I want to be able to testify. Watch it, Tanya, now. Don't make me. I want to prophesy to most of you that when your mother, I wish I could preach, and your father forsake you, the Lord said, I'll raise you up. And right now, God didn't let some of you have mothers and fathers because your case was a case for him. Oh, y'all didn't catch that. I said he allowed you to be hurt so he could step in and help. And sometimes help comes in all disguises, all shapes and forms. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm not even old enough to be something to you, but tell them I'm powerful enough to help you get out of what you're in. Testify. Tell them you ain't the only one that's been hurt. You ain't the only one that's been broke. You're not the only one that's been molested. You're not the only one that's been cheated on. But when I look back over my life and I think things over, Chantel, all of my good days, I'm about to get out of here, Janice, they outweigh my bad days. If you ever want God to smile at you, make him proud. Show him in the midst of adversity, I will bless the Lord at all times. Yep, the decorum, the behavior, the persona of Mother's Day is everyone supposed to look cute. Everyone is not supposed to sweat because we made reservations somewhere. But my disposition this morning is I don't care what I look like. I need God to get me out of what I'm in right now.
You ought to shake three people's hands and act like you're a member of the 1403 and tell them, I promise you that you will be delivered before you walk out this door. Tell them God is about to reverse what you've been going through for the past 3, 4, 5 years. And when the devil sees you, you let him know you should have killed me. When you had me, you ought to grab somebody and tell them you looking at a dead man walking. Cause tell them I should have been dead already. But tell them something on the inside is working on the outside. I thought I had my church. What a change in my life. Why don't some of y'all grab somebody else and say Happy Mother's Day? But tell them what I want you to know is before your mama knew your daddy, God already anointed you, already chose you. It's not the womb he put you in. And it's not the tomb you're gonna die in. It's how you live between the dash. How you live between your birthday and your exit. What does your dash look like? My dash looks like bills paid, body healed, burdens lifted, children saved. You ought to tell somebody, what does your dash look like? It looks like heart fixed, mind made up. I got my mind stayed on Jesus. You ought to, I guess y'all want to have church then. You ought to grab somebody else and tell your neighbor, hey there, hey there, the worst is over and the best is yet to come. If you mean that, tell somebody else and say, hey there, hey there, the worst is over and the best is yet to come. Congratulate your neighbor and say, how did you turn out so well without both parents or having to raise yourself? Tell them it's as simple as this. Have you tried Jesus? You tried Jesus? He's out. Oh, oh, he's all right. Y'all still don't want to preach. My preachers ain't helping me preach. Talking to me. I close my iPad, but the bottom notes, Tracy, says how do we come into this world? If you come out the wrong way, it's called breach. Y'all ain't talking to me. And when you breach, you gotta trust the hands of a specialist to start maneuvering you, to get you back in the right posture. Y'all ain't talking to me. When they put themselves into your private areas. Right now, God is about to bless some of you because he's invaded your private area and he's twisted you. Move you back into good posture. And when you come out, you know when you're right because these are the words that should make 10 of you scream. When you're born right, you come out head first. And some of y'all that's been treated like the tail, God said, I'll make the tail, the head, I'll make the last first. Lean on your neighbor and tell them you're created to come out first. Tell them head first and let the devil know Both of you pull each other and see which one is stronger. And tell your neighbor, this way is from Jacksonville, Florida. Our pastor heard it from another preacher that he's giving kudos to. And he don't know where the other preacher got it from. But tell him you're going to be somebody by tomorrow morning. Because the God in me is quickening the God in you. So shake him and rock him. Rock him and shake him. Shake him and rock him. Rock him and shake him. And tell him, come on out of there. Come out with your hands up. Come out with your mouth open. And let the devil know. Nope.
Hallelujah.
Lukubriansia Bakonda. Listen. Ashana Mahai. Listen. All of you that have been going through something that you really can't express, and you feel like you haven't found someone you can tell it to without it leaking, God said for the next 30 seconds, your praise is going to create a new dynamic. God says, I'm going to send people that can handle your hard places. And I'm sending them not to fight you, but to fight everything else around you. But you got 30 seconds to praise him right now, any way you choose. And I mean praise him like... No more dancing, just to dance. All of you that know that it should have been another way, and the devil had several opportunities to hang you, but God is about to give you a new lease on life. I don't care if your dance looks retarded. I don't care if your mouth is big. If you know that by tomorrow you coming out better than you were today, you got 1 minute to praise him. Watch it, Elder. Praise them, children. Praise!
majority of you that are good or blessed enough to find somebody within your parameters that will dance with you, get them to dance with you at least 20 seconds. Within 20 seconds, I believe the Holy Ghost will release you from all the damage that's been done to you over the past 10 years. But you've got to find somebody else that's concerned about your well-being. Get them right now and dance with them, clap with them, run with them, meet with them, jump with them. Get them.
This is a good minute for you to go grab your children and hug on them and be whisper and tell the devil, you can't have these. These belong to me. You can't have my house. You can't have my children. You can't have my family. These belong to me. Hallelujah. Good time to anoint your own kids. You don't need your pastor for this one. This is a good time for you to let the devil know, I birthed this. I feed this. I cover this. Yep. This will be a day we all remember. Some of you don't know I'm prophetic, but you can speak your children's name right where you sit, and God will go get them right where they are. Speak their names in the atmosphere and watch what the Lord does. Hallelujah. Even the names of your stepchildren, your adopted children, your God children. Hallelujah. 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 Hey, Shanamando Rabaka. Risilikunda Raman Soria Bakaya. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. F sharp on that piano. D flat. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God,
that is who you are.
Oh, I'm Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Everybody that has a voice, help me say, promise keeper. Time, everybody say,
oh, 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 oh.
I see the brothers singing it, so I'm happy.
Waymaker,
miracle worker, promise keeper.
Oh, my God, that is who you are.
Sing it again, everybody.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper.
Bow your heads. Woo! Shanda Daba. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. Hey! Holy, holy! This is your time to get it right, right where you are. You and the Lord can correct some things right where you are. Power of God is heavy. Sing it one more time with no music.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
Hey,
my God, that is who you are.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, we're about to go home. We're going to sow in a minute.
Way, miracle work,
oh Lord.
Light in the darkness, my God, that is.
One time, old saints. Then sings my soul, my Savior God. I see so many of you singing from your heart. That's beautiful.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Heads bowed, eyes closed. I know this is not Christmas, but I hear the Lord so clear. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us
adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ alone, for he alone is worthy.
I see angels.
For he alone is worthy. For he alone is worthy. Christ alone.
Y'all feel that? The Lord said, Todd, I love them.
In him there is no failure. In him there is no failure.
Come on.
In him there is no failure.
We're about to go to treat our mothers, the mothers I don't have, who's gone. I've given cards to the mothers where they can go eat on me or do whatever they want to do with their money. Just because I don't have a biological mother doesn't mean I don't have mothers. I appreciate Yvonne McDougal Hall, who may be watching, for raising me all of these years and taking care of me as if I was her own, still living. I appreciate her stepping in when God called my mother out. Thank you, Mommy. Can I get you to not just grab the easiest offering, but to grab something challenging, John? Y'all get your offerings ready. Can't tell you what to give. I'm not going to even give an amount today. Spend some on your mothers. Jesus. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost is in this room.
Honor and power unto the Lord.
Yes, the Lord.
The Lord our God is our gift.
The Lord our God.
The Lord our God.
He is. Play it, play it, play it, play it. All right, Sophie, all praises. Sopranos, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Out toes, come on, join it.
Oh, pray.
Hallelujah.
tenors join in.
Hallelujah. Salvation and glory. Honor and power. He is Lord.
Come on, y'all, sing it. Let me hear you. Do your part.
If you know that you're offering your gift, your seed, your donation, that your giving is honorable, come now and sow your seed in Jesus' name. Make sure it's honorable after such a wonderful day. Make sure it's honorable. Make sure it's honorable. God loves a cheerful giver. All praises be to the King of Kings and the Lord, our God. He is wonderful. All praise. God bless you, Mother. This be to the King of Kings and the Lord our God. He's wonderful.
Come here. Let me have your ear.
Has everybody brought, has everyone given? Has everyone given? If you have not and you want to, you can come at this time. We don't want you to be like other people who eat and don't sow where they grow. You have to learn to sow where you grow. Sow where you grow. Somebody say, sow where you grow. You have to learn to sow where you grow. Somebody's hitting some clean notes. I don't know who it is. It's who? Y'all need to stop that. Let's see if y'all can really do it. Well, do it.